I'm going to talk to you in some detail about Edward Said and his book Orientalism. Edward Said was born in 1935 in Palestine and he died in 2003. Said was a professor of literature at Columbia University in the United States. Said was also a public intellectual who involved in public debates on Palestine issue. He was involved politically in the Palestine issue. And he was also an accomplished pianist. He has also written books and articles on music. Edward Said's Orientalism was published in 1978. And it was one of the most important books that formed the backdrop of post-colonial studies. In this book, Said critiques a set of beliefs or representations of the East by the West, which he calls Orientalism. He is criticizing how the West looks at the East. I will tell you more about it presently. This practice of the West looking at the East in a peculiar way, according to Said, went back to ancient Greece. In ancient Greece, there was Aeschylus who wrote the play The Persians. The depiction of the Easterners as violent and uncouth barbarians began in this play itself. In the 17th century, there was the time of European enlightenment. And at this time also started the colonization of the Arab world. People began traveling to the Middle East. And they began to depict the Middle East in the time of the Enlightenment as a place that is very strange, very different from the West. This was the beginning of Orientalism. By the 19th century, much of the Ottoman Empire was colonized by the Europeans. The Ottomans were very powerful before in the medieval period. The Europeans, with gunpowder, defeated the Ottoman Empire. And in the 19th century, Orientalist depictions of the Arabs abounded. There were many paintings and artworks, literary works also, that depicted the Ottoman Empire and its people in an Orientalist manner. The Europeans imagined the Arabs and their culture in an exaggerated and distorted manner, according to Said. Said shows that the Europeans imagined the Arab culture in an exaggerated and distorted manner. Examples are 19th century European Orientalist art and photographs of the later time, images from the Great Exhibition of London and the World's Fairs in the US. World's Fairs were a series of exhibitions that happened in the US starting from the 19th century. And postcards depicting Algerian women circulated by colonial Frenchmen. At the time, France colonized Algeria and colonial Frenchmen depicted Algerian women on postcards and circulated them. That is also given as an example of Orientalism. Let us take a look at the pictures themselves. These are some of the postcards. Algerian women dressed in a very peculiar fashion, depicted as savages, not even human, or as sensuous. Algerian women depicted half naked. Algerian women lounging. The interesting thing is, all these looked like everyday snapshots of Algerian women's lives. But in reality, these women were brought to the studio and they were made to dress up and pose like this. It was not real everyday life. Now, pictures of the Great Exhibition of London. This is the Turkish bazaar setting. The whole exhibition hall that depicted Turkey is decorated like a Turkish bazaar. Look at all the Orientalist wonderful, wonderful exotic things that are depicted here. Animal skins, horns. You should understand that in all the other halls, they were, you know, depicting countries of the West. There were machinery, signs of progress, but the Eastern Hall was depicted in a very primitive, exotic manner. Then Orientalist art of the 19th century. The Orient has been represented as exotic, colorful, and sensual in paintings. And it concentrated on Near Eastern Islamic cultures, as those were the ones visited by artists as France became more engaged in North Africa. The Middle East and North Africa are nearby. They did not talk about the Far East or India at this time in the 19th century. French artists such as Eugène Delacroix, Jean-Léon Gérôme, Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres, etc., painted many works depicting Islamic culture, often including lounging female slaves. They are waiting for some lovers without doing any work, sensuous pictures, sensual pictures. And they were called the odalisques. These Turkish female slaves were called the odalisques. They stressed both lassitude or lethargy and visual spectacle. These paintings focused on the lethargy of Oriental life as well as the spectacle, the fighting, the murder, the killing, bloodshed, such spectacle also. Look at the lounging people, lethargy. Look at the spectacle, half-naked bodies. This is like savage. This is like not even human. The massacre at Chios, that is the painting. Look at the Raft of the Medusa by Theodore Jericho. So spectacular. Look at the colors. Look at the, again, lounging. Whereas the Westerners will all be dressed in suits and doing very formal things, professional things. The Women of Algiers by Eugène Delacroix. Again, lounging, waiting for their lovers to come home, probably. The Turkish Bath by Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres. So sensual. Western men all caught the next ship, got onto the next ship and came to Turkey after this. Edward says Orientalism is a critique of such depictions of the Orient. Say the draws on Foucault and Gramsci. Foucault's concept of discourse. Foucault's concept of power knowledge. How? Power works as a discourse. The Orientalist depictions in art show the how the power of the West possesses the East. The discourse of Orientalism is the discourse of how power, hegemonic power, if you use Gramsci's term, works on the East. The Orient is a stereotype for the Westerner. The Orient is always seen as either lazy or sensual or violent. It is a stereotype. First and foremost, the Orient is a Western construction, says Said, rather than a reality. In Orientalist art, what you see is not the reality of the Orient. What you see is a stereotype, a construction. Said exposes Eurocentric universalism that takes for granted white superiority. He exposes the white racial prejudices, Eurocentrism, that takes for granted white superiority. Orientalism refers to the European cultural tradition of defining and identifying the East as other and as inferior to the West. The East is always inferior to the West. Said offers three definitions of Orientalism. All three were controversial, actually. Orientalism, he says, is an academic field in the West. Orientalism is a study. Westerners studied India, studied Persia. Indology used to be a science. So Orientalism is a scientific field in the, academic field in the West, rooted in 19th century pseudo-scientific theories of race. Orientalism is defined, secondly, as a way of seeing the world. It is a means of seeing the world. How do you see the world? In an Orientalist manner, based upon the distinctions between the East and the West. East is different from the West. East is East and West is West. Never the twain shall meet, said Rudyard Kipling. So, East and West are completely different, they think. And Easterners are not even like human beings. And how do you see the world based on this idea? That is also Orientalism. Second definition. Thirdly, Orientalism is a Western style of hegemony, of dominating over the Orient. Your Orientalism is a style of dominating over the Orient, restructuring, redefining the Orient, having authority over the Orient. These are the three definitions. Now I have given some excerpts, two excerpts from Orientalism. It will be clear to the reader that by Orientalism, I mean several things, says Saeed. All of them, in my opinion, interdependent. Orientalism is not just one thing, it is several things, all interdependent. The most readily accepted designation for Orientalism is an academic one. The first definition is academic. And indeed, the label still serves in a number of academic institutions. Middle Eastern studies, China studies, etc. India studies are there in academic institutions. Anyone who teaches, writes about or researches the Orient. And this applies whether the person is an anthropologist, sociologist, historian, philologist. All of them who research the Orient, either in its specific or its general aspects, is an Orientalist. Because he's an academic who does this. And what he or she says or does is Orientalism. That is how he makes the first definition. Then later on he says, the Orient is not only adjacent to Europe. It is also the place of Europe's greatest and richest and oldest colonies. The Orient or the East is not only lying near the West. It is also the source of Europe's riches, wealth. It is the greatest, richest and oldest colonies, the source of its civilizations and languages, its cultural contestant. That means the East and West are constantly fighting over culture, and one of its deepest and most recurring images of the other. For the Europeans, Orient is the other. In addition, the Orient has helped to define Europe. You define Europe as what is not Orient. So, Orient has helped to define Europe or the West as its contrasting image, contrasting idea, contrasting personality or experience. Orient is lazy. They are always languishing. Lethargy they have. That means Occident is not lazy, productive, smart. Like that. Europe or Occident or West is defined in terms of the Orient. Yet, none of this Orient is merely imaginative. The Orient is an integral part of European material, civilization and culture. All these are not only imaginative. They are not only imagining the Orient as an exotic thing. The Orient is also very materialistically connected to the West. It is very much part of the material civilization and culture of the West. For example, in all British houses that value culture, you might see Chinese blue and white pottery. Chinese or Persian, both are there. Chinese or Persian blue and white china, blue and white pottery. That is part of Western culture now, but that is originally Oriental. Things like that. Orientalism expresses and represents that part culturally and even ideologically as a mode of discourse with supporting institutions. Orientalism has supporting institutions. Vocabulary, supporting scholarship. What do you mean by that? Christianity as an institution is the right religion. Orientals do not have religion. They are all savages. They need to follow Christianity. This is the institutional support of Orientalism. Orientalism has its own vocabulary in Heart of Darkness. Joseph Conrad is using a lot of words like nigger to refer to the blacks. It has its own ways of speaking, its own scholarship, its own imagery, its own doctrines, even colonial bureaucracies and colonial styles, says Edward Said. Now, the Orient becomes a projection of those aspects of the Occident which the Westerners do not wish to acknowledge in themselves. For example, I belong to one culture. Let me give you an example. I belong to one culture. There is another culture or opposite culture near our place. I don't like them. They are my other. I define them as evil and violent because I know that evil and violence are there in me also. But I'm afraid to acknowledge it in myself. So I dump those values on the other. You go to somebody's house. The lady of the house comes. Oh, my child has made the whole place disordered. He has scattered all his toys here. I'm so sorry. Suppose she says. She knows that it is not only the child. She could also have kept the house neat and tidy. She does not want to say, she does not want to say that I am not neat and tidy. I did not keep my house properly. That is why my house is unclean. Instead, she says, oh, my child has, strewn everything about. She is attributing to the child those values that she is afraid to acknowledge in herself. Now, did you understand? The Orient becomes a projection of those aspects of the Occident which the Westerners do not wish to acknowledge in themselves. The Westerners know that they have cruelty, they have decadence, they have sensuality, laziness, and so on. But they attribute all these qualities to the Orient. Orientalism also means that the East is seen as the exotic other or the demonic other. East is seen as a fascinating realm of the exotic, the mystical, and the seductive. Exotic, beautiful. At the same time, East is seen as dangerous, sensual, and violent also. Demonic. Orientalism also involves a homogeneity. Orient, by the Westerner, the Orient is seen as homogeneous. Anonymous masses with instinctive emotions rather than conscious actions. If you read Passage to India, you see all the illiterate Indians, the villagers, all thronging like a crowd, masses. In the film Gandhi, you can see Indians. All masses. Only the Westerners and the Western educated Indians have individuality. The Orient is seen as if we are all cattle, as if we are homogeneous, as if we don't have individuality, as anonymous masses with instinctive emotions rather than conscious actions. The actions and emotions that are attributed to the Orient are judged racially. Orientalism is a judgment. Ah, he is Chinese, so he will have this emotion. He is Japanese, he will be cunning. He is Indian, he will be treacherous, like that. Actions and emotions are judged racially, as if all Indians will be lazy or all Japanese are cunning, etc. Then, Said said, Orientalism enables the political, cultural, and social domination of the West. West dominates over the East. The domination by the West, not only during colonial times, but also in the present times. There is something called Neo-Orientalism. There is Orientalism now also. I will come to that presently. There are two epigraphs in the book Orientalism. The book Orientalism begins with two epigraphs. One, they cannot represent themselves. They must be represented. It is a quotation from Karl Marx. The East is a career. That is another epigraph taken from Benjamin Disraeli's Tancred. It's a novel. So there is an epigraph from Karl Marx and Benjamin Disraeli. There are two kinds of Orientalism Edward Said talks about. Latent and manifest Orientalism. Latent Orientalism is what lies inside. The unconscious and the untouchable positivity or certainty regarding what the Orient is. In other words, latent Orientalism refers to that feeling in the Westerner's mind that he is certain that Orient must be eccentric or backward or sensual, passive, etc. For example, the Westerner is going to some city in Africa. He has never gone there before. He has never seen Africa. But the Westerner has a deep belief, an unconscious belief that it is Africa. It will be violent. It will be backward. It will be poor. That latent unconscious certainty about the Orient, unchanging certainty about the Orient, is called latent Orientalism. Let me tell you something controversial and political. Indians have the latent Orientalist idea that all Kashmiris are terrorists. All Kashmiris are not terrorists. Cannot be terrorists. All people in a region cannot be terrorists. All Pakistanis are bad. Indians have the latent Orientalist belief. Now you understand. It also refers to the unanimous and stable perceptions of the Orient. The unanimous, everybody believes it about the Orient, that they are all eccentric, backward, sensual, etc. That is a stable perception, unchanging. What is manifest Orientalism? Manifest Orientalism is the belief that is the latent belief that is expressed in the form of knowledge or writing. Manifest Orientalism is the stated views about Orientalist society, languages, all the writing that has been made about their history, sociology, etc. Manifest Orientalism refers to the information and changes in the knowledge of the Orient. Regarding the Orient, whatever knowledge we have, the changes in that knowledge, whatever information we have, the writing we have, that is Manifest Orientalism. Now, let me come to contemporary Orientalism and Islamophobia. Islamophobia is rooted in Orientalism. Neo-Orientalism is the modern incarnation of Orientalist thinking. Neo-Orientalism is the modern incarnation of the 19th century Orientalist thinking. Today also we have it in the West. Islam was always represented as a pale imitation of Christianity because Islam came after Christianity. They did not even regard Islam as another religion. It was considered a fraudulent imitation of Christianity. That is an Orientalist belief. This translates as the fear of Islam. They don't trust Islam culturally, collectively. That is latent Orientalism. And they began to fear Islam at some point. And the Islamic warriors, the conquest that the Islamic conquerors made, all added to Islamophobia. For the contemporary neo-Orientalist, there is a support system of staggering power. America and across the world, many, many nations support Islamophobia. They all propagate the idea that terrorism is associated with Islam. So, for the contemporary neo-Orientalist, there is a support system of staggering power based on the myths that Orientalism propagates. It is very sad. And it is far from the truth, according to Said. This means that in today's world, to write about the Oriental Arab world is to write with authority. We know Arabs are like that. To write with unquestioning certainty. Whatever we say from the Orientalist perspective about the Arabs become absolute truth, backed by absolute force. This refers to how Western debates envision Islam. In the Western debates, Islam is seen as, Muslim communities are seen as violent. And this in turn shapes social attitudes, cultural perceptions, and political ideology. Social attitudes, take the case of India or USA, social attitudes, cultural perceptions, political ideology are all colored and shaped and defined by this rather unfair prejudice against Islam. I have a picture here of Islamophobia, suspect, Muslim, terrorist, prisoner. Saddam, Al-Qaeda, fanatic, fundamentalist, Taliban. It is important we understand Orientalism in this context also. Now, a critique of Said's views on Orientalism. Said's views on Orientalism were highly influential, but at the same time, very controversial. Many people attacked Edward Said, and his book led to a lot of debates. Said generalizes and homogenizes the Western views of the Orient. Said is homogenizing or looking at all the Western views as the same. Even as Said criticizes the Western prejudice, he seems to be prejudiced against the West. So, Said is accused of the same cultural essentialism that he claimed to reject. Said generalizes, critics say that Said generalizes the Western views of the Orient and attributes racism to all Orientalists. Said is accused of politicizing the scientific discipline of Middle Eastern studies. Middle Eastern studies is not all bad. It is a scientific discipline, but he politicized it. People have criticized. Ijaz Ahmed, in his famous book, In Theory, criticizes Said for dubbing Marx as an Orientalist, for using the same Western approaches that he condemned in order to criticize Orientalism. He is using Western approaches to criticize Orientalism, and these Western approaches are largely inaccessible to colonized people. That is what Ijaz Ahmed says. Also note, the term Occidentalism has emerged to represent stereotypes of the West. If Orientalism refers to stereotypes of the East, Occidentalism is a term, people have written books on it, that represents stereotypes of the West. That is all about Orientalism. Now you should read on your own, browse on your own, do reading and research on your own. Every video of mine should be supplemented with your reading and research. This is not a course that aims to do spoon feeding. Spoon feeding should not be done. It will not help you. I have given you directions. Look up the terms and everything that I said on your own. Browse and read and make your own notes from not only this video, but also from your own reading. Okay? So that is the end of this lecture.